Good evening. Welcome to the William G. McGowan Theater at the National Archives. And welcome to those of you joining us on YouTube, and a special welcome to our friends at WJLA who are with us tonight. I'm David Ferriero, the Archivist of the United States, and I'm very pleased to open this program on DC statehood and representative democracy. Especially pleased to open it since I'm a DC resident. The city was established as a federal district run by Congress. Today, it's more than just a federal district. It's one of the nation's largest cities whose population exceeds that of some states. Yet the district's citizens do not have full voting rights in Congress. Instead, a delegate without the same rights as our representatives. Tonight, a panel of experts will discuss the current state of our representative democracy. We're once again pleased to present a program in partnership with the U.S. Association of Former Members of Congress, and we thank them for their continued support. Before we move on to tonight's discussions, I'd like to remind you of some upcoming events here at the National Archives. A week from Saturday, a date you should know, please join us for our annual Independence Day program, which includes a dramatic reading of the Declaration of Independence on our Constitution Avenue steps and activities for children of all ages here in the building. The festivities start at 10 a.m. on July 4th, and it's the best seat in town to watch the parade, which starts just after our program. On Thursday, July 16th at 7 p.m. here in the McGowan Theater, we'll present a Writers and Scholars Roundtable on Civil Rights, featuring revealing personal accounts from three Pulitzer Prize-winning authors and a veteran civil rights activist. They'll explore some of the critical and little-known events of the civil rights era. The program will include a short performance by the Howard University Vocal Jazz Ensemble, Afro Blue. This program is presented in partnership with the 2015 March on Washington Film Festival. If you want to know more about these and all of our upcoming events and public programs, check out our monthly calendar of events. There are copies of the calendar in the lobby, as well as sign-up sheets where you can receive them in regular mail or in email. And another way to get more involved with the National Archives is to become a member of the National Archives Foundation. The foundation supports all of our education and outreach activities, and there are applications for membership in the lobby also. And a little known secret that I'll share with you, no one has ever been turned down for membership in the foundation. The story of Washington, D.C.'s governance can be found here in the records of the government of the District of Columbia, and in the records of the House of Representatives and the Senate's separate committees on the District of Columbia. Congressional records are held in our Center for Legislative Archives and available to Congress whenever they need them. The 1,600 cubic feet of records of the government of the District of Columbia date from 1791 to 1978. For most of the 19th and 20th centuries, the House and Senate committees pretty much ran the District of Columbia, until home rule was established in 1973. Congressional committees, however, continue to exercise oversight over the federal district today. Tonight's distinguished panel will provide a fresh look at the current state of affairs in our capital city. To introduce the panel, I'd like to turn the program over to the president of the U.S. Association of Former Members of Congress, Barbara Kennelly. Barbara served 17 years in the House of Representatives, representing the first district of Connecticut. She was the first woman named Chief Deputy Majority Whip. Barbara is the founder and president of her own advocacy organization and is a distinguished professor of political science at Trinity Washington University here in D.C. Please welcome Barbara Kennelly.
Thank you. Good evening. Before we begin, let me thank the National Archives and its outstanding archivist right there, David Ferriero. He's been partnering with the former members for a number of years, and it's really a wonderful thing because this auditorium is able to, we are able to use this auditorium, and we thank you again and again for this partnership. The collaboration going on so many years now has become one of our organization's most treasured and valuable projects. It enables us to connect the public with bipartisan groups of former and also current now members of Congress. and we have a productive and respectful discussions about the issues of the day. I do thank you. I also would like to take a moment to mention archivist Alan Weinstein, who passed away this week. Alan was the 9th archivist of the United States. He was a brilliant scholar and a proud American who dedicated his life to promoting our Constitution and protecting our citizens' freedom. Alan's tenure with the archives was relatively short, but his contributions to the knowledge of our nation's history will last for generations. Our association, the Former Members Association, has over 600 members of the former members of the House and the Senate, and we're not funded by Congress, and we don't take one penny from the taxpayers. But what we do is we focus on civic education domestically and democracy building overseas. So we have a whole program in the United States, and then we have another program where we send people overseas to explain our system of government. Former members of Congress who participate in our projects donate their time and their expertise because they strongly believe in the value of our organization, which are that bipartisanship, transparency, and really listening to the other's point of view are the hallmarks of good government. We invite the audience, and I do hope that you will participate in this dialogue, and we ask you to contribute your opinions in a productive and respectful manner, just like our panelists will do tonight. Our topic will be, and that's why you're here, DC statehood and voter ID laws. This is a very complex subject, and for many, it's an emotional subject. And I'm delighted that you're here to listen to us tonight. Now, you're going to have the panel, which we are very proud of the members that have decided to be with us tonight. First, you're going to hear from Jim Moran, who has just left the Congress. Jim has been a Democratic member of Congress from 1991 to 2015, representing Virginia, the 8th Congressional District, which includes Arlington County and a large portion of Fairfax County. He was probably a congressman for many of you in this audience. After Jim Moran, we're going to hear from Jim Walsh, a Republican from upstate New York, who has served in the House of Representatives from 1989 to 2009. In addition to a number of other important assignments, Jim was chairman of the House Appropriations Committee and Subcommittee on the District of Columbia. Jim is also vice president of the Former Members Association. Many of you certainly remember the long and distinguished service of Tony Williams as he was the mayor, the 5th mayor of the District of Columbia, and a very, very popular mayor. We are thrilled tonight that we're going to have Eleanor Holmes Norton on the panel. She's going to be a little late. I happen to teach in Washington at Trinity University, and my students absolutely adore Eleanor Holmes Norton. She's just beyond the beyond when we talk about her. Then our moderator, we're very fortunate in our moderator tonight, is Leonard Steinhorn, a former political speechwriter who now teaches politics and communications at the American University. Letty also has written a number of books, included By the Color of Our Skin, which focuses on our country's racial divisions. He's a frequent commentator of CBS, Fox, and CNN. Thank you all for coming in. We all look forward to the panel. The panel?
Yeah, Ellen is going to be here.
Okay, so
right on time. What an answer.
Thank you all for being here. We just got through the difficult part, which is finding our seats. Tonight is an opportunity that I hope we will be able to shed light and not only generate heat. But it does involve a key issue that's central to our republic, which is democracy, representation, taxation without representation, politics, partisanship, and the Constitution. So all of these issues are going to be blended into our conversation here tonight. We're going to have an opportunity to hear different sides, different perspectives. talk about some of the current issues that aren't only related to the district, but also to voting rights and voter ID laws and those issues related to it, because many people make that connection. So without further ado, I want to be able to engage our panel. We have an incredibly distinguished panel here, and we're honored to have them here. So I'm going to kick out the first question to somebody just for context, okay, which is, why don't we have representation in Congress for the District of Columbia? Anyone want to take a take at that?
Jim Walsh. Take a crack at it. Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here with all these very distinguished public servants this evening. I don't have staff anymore, so I had to do the research myself. It may be somewhat incomplete, but I tried to be holistic about it. But it's amazing how much thought was given to this capital in those times of great trial and tribulation. But remember, the first time these individuals met for the Continental Congress in Philadelphia, they were in a state. And then the capitals moved to York, Pennsylvania, to New York City. So they had an experience dealing with states while they dealt with a temporary capital. I suspect there were some lessons that were learned there. And then when the Constitution was written, very early on in the Constitution, Article 1, Section 8, established that there would be a national capital and that it would be on neutral ground, that it would not be a part or parcel of any individual state. It would be separate. And I suspect that the lessons that they learned, whether moving from place to place, was instructive about that. But it's also amazing how many times they dealt with this issue and continued to decide not to change its status to a state. First the Constitution, then the Residence Act of 1790 established this plot of land as the capital, part of Virginia, part of Maryland, not all in one or the other. The Organic Act of 1801 officially placed the District of Columbia under the control of Congress, 1801. In 1961, the United States, the people of the United States voted for the 23rd Amendment to the Constitution, which provided the District of Columbia with three electoral votes to give people in the District of Columbia the opportunity to vote for President of the United States. But they did not in 1961 or 1801 or 1790 decide that it should be a state. They decided that it should not be a state. And then lastly, in 1973, and my father voted for this. My dad was a member of Congress. He was also mayor of Syracuse, for the Home Rule Law, which created the district government. Again, they decided not to make it a state. So there's a lot of history there.
Please.
First of all, I want to say that it's a great pleasure, Matt, not only to be with you, a particular forum like this, but with two distinguished former members of Congress and a distinguished former mayor of the District of Columbia. Now, these two members of Congress were both on the Appropriations Committee, and they were both, one is a Republican, one is a Democrat, guess which one. And they were both good and fair to the district, so I appreciate being here with the participants. Jim has told you why we weren't a state and why we weren't a state, but that wasn't your question. It was, why does the District of Columbia not have voting rights? You will not find discussions in the Federalist Papers or anywhere else about why we don't have voting rights, because it is impossible to believe that the framers who went to war on the slogan of no taxation without representation would have left, of all places, this capital city without voting rights. It's true that it believed that Congress, once the federal enclave was passed to the jurisdiction, would in fact empower them. And let me say why I think that is the case and where the precedent is. The two states that ceded the District of Columbia, or the land, Maryland, Virginia, did so in 1790. there was a 10-year period of transition until this city became the seat of government. Now, it is very important to note, if you want to know the intent of the framers, and by the way, the people in the and the first Congress also were those who wrote the Constitution. In those 10 years, they made it clear that during that transition period, they did this by themselves, saying this was as a federal matter, this is the Congress, they shall have voting rights. Those voting rights will be the same rights that you have had in Maryland and Virginia. So it is Congress, by statute, that made sure that those who were living in what was to become the District of Columbia had voting rights. And please understand, that is Congress that essentially took those rights from them when that land passed to the jurisdiction of the federal government. And by the way, they were so outraged, they who had been residents of Maryland, Virginia, who had every right that everybody else had, that the first thing they did in 1801 was to go into the streets and demand that the Congress of the United States give them their rights back. And we have been making that demand for more than 200 years ever since.
Anyone else want to jump in on that? All right. Well, let me ask a question then.
Well, I have one more piece of context. That I got read a lot of histories of the district during my time as mayor, and one of them was a two-volume history by Constance Green, and the Continental Congress was meeting in Philadelphia, and there was a run on the Congress by the Revolutionary War veterans who wanted, like veterans until World War II, their payment. The state agreed with the veterans. Congress had to leave, which was a lot of the impetus for trying to create something special, but that's it. I know this is on the wall of the archives. In this case, I believe and I hope that past isn't prologue. So.
Well, all right, so let me just jump in and probe this just for a couple of seconds before we get into some of the politics. If the intent was to provide voting rights, why was that not written into the Constitution? Some of the arguments are that, and this some people may find this humorous, that all the members of Congress would take an ownership stake in the District of Columbia, and therefore, that the District of Columbia would have all of these representatives caring about its fate. Some people have argued that. And some people say, well, it's not a state. It doesn't have the jurisdiction of a state. It's not mentioned in the Constitution that it would be a state. And where it is mentioned in the Constitution is similar to congressional authority over forts, or let's say the post office, and therefore no one would say that a particular fort ought to have representation in Congress. So let's see if anyone wants to take any of those arguments on.
I wish we'd stop confusing being a state and voting rights.
Okay.
Because... yes, we want statehood, and by the way, I'm pleased to announce that a bill was introduced in the Senate, a companion bill to my bill, with a record number of co-sponsors to make the district the 51st state, and was introduced today. I have a bill in the House that would make that has 120 co-sponsors, and that these bills are introduced with members already on the bill, I think does indicate that we understand to get all of our rights, for example, to keep the Congress interfering with our affairs, we would need to be a state. But we wouldn't have to be a state in order to have taxation without representation. What nonsense to have the District of Columbia pay federal taxes and go to war. And yet when the time comes to debate whether to go to the war, those who pay those taxes have no say whatsoever. I have a voting committee, but no say whatsoever. And it should be known, in case you did not know it,
When I say we pay taxes without representation, per capita it is $12,000 per resident. That is more than the taxes paid by any residents of any state in the union. So, you know, you can talk about states all you want to, but the form that it takes should, in a democracy, surely not determine whether or not you have to be treated like colonials or somebody who has to just do what I say do, but have no say in what is to be done. So whether you believe that is a matter of philosophy, as a matter of democratic logic, there are only two capitals that are in the predicament that we are in, and they are in autocratic or authoritarian countries.
All right, then final question along those lines. Doesn't the Constitution say that it's the state's responsibility and authority to select its representatives? And it specifically uses the word state in there, okay? So if that's the case, how do you get around that to provide representation in the light of what the Constitution might say?
If I could go back to how the Congress handled this during transition. Those who lived in Virginia during transition would have been robbed of their ability to vote. What Congress did was to say, you will have the right to vote by law of the Congress of the United States. And it is the Congress of the United States that took it away. So if you want a precedent, it seems to me that one ought to look at what the Congress has actually done. And what it has actually done is conferred voting rights on the District of Columbia. By the way, it conferred a delegate on the District of Columbia who can vote in committee. It did that, and nobody's found that unconstitutional.
All right, well, then let's move from the past to the present and future. In any of our lifetimes, the lifetime of this next generation, are we going to see District of Columbia either become a state or obtain full or even partial representation in Congress, and why not? So use that crystal ball, look into the politics, look into what might happen. Anyone want to run with that? Congressman Moran?
No, the District of Columbia is not going to get statehood, nor the representation that it should, in my belief, get in the Senate and the House for quite some time. The reality, as Ellen knows all too well, is that this is not a constitutional issue. We do change the Constitution or even find ways around the Constitution if the political will is there. While there may have been more justification at the time to carve out the District of Columbia than, for example, to define African Americans as only a fraction of a person in the Constitution, the Constitution can and would evolve, but it does so when there is a political reason to do so. And right now, the politics are on the other side. The majority of the House and Senate, being Republican, they have no interest in diluting their influence by increasing the influence of the Democratic caucus, because the two members of Congress would assuredly be Democratic. The two senators would surely be Democratic, as would the member of Congress. So it's not in their interest. And I don't think that's going to, the makeup of the Congress is not likely to change until 2022 at the earliest, after the next census. So that's the reality. Now, you know, you can make a moral argument, which I think is compelling. You can work hard, as Eleanor has and as Tony did and still is, and showing the pragmatic reasonableness of making D.C. a state. But I don't see it it changing. Now, I will say, too, just to throw another aspect of this discussion, which should probably be addressed in this context, is that part of the reason that D.C. wasn't made a state is because it was majority-minority. And the voters, the people, the population of the District of Columbia were part of a disenfranchised minority. And in the 1960s, when maybe you could have done it, when there was an overwhelming Democratic Congress under Kennedy and even more so under Johnson, the Southern Democrats were racists for the most part. And they weren't going to make D.C. a state. They loved controlling D.C. And in many ways, and we know many of these people. They became iconic in back in their home state of South Carolina or wherever by beating up on the District of Columbia. So there's no question that some of this has been racist. Now, the city has evolved now. 48% of the population is black, and it's becoming gentrified. And as you get more middle class people who have grown up accepting the idea that they should and will be enfranchised politically, there'll be more pressure. But even having said that, I just don't see this Congress doing what I would consider to be the right thing. I do appreciate the fact that Tom Carper has raised the issue, and Eleanor has worked hard and gotten, 160 signatures or something. But virtually all are Democrats. Do you have any Republicans on there? Not a Republican. So, you know, that's just the political reality. That doesn't mean we shouldn't have panels like this and raise the issue and make the prevailing party at least explain themselves to the extent they can.
Mayor Williams?
I think a couple of things. I mean, one problem I know mayors faces on the one hand, and I know Eleanor appreciates this, because you're trying to run the city. So on the one hand, you're going around, you know, Hell's Half Acre saying, oh, the city's great, please invest in our city, it's a wonderful city. But you're also making this argument that the denial of voting rights, these are fundamental voting rights, which is a fundamental right, is an injury to the district and to its citizens, and it's a hard argument to make. And to Jim's political point, this is just an aside, I knew we were having this discussion, and last week I went fishing in Alaska, which would be ordinarily neither here nor there, except that when you go into the Anchorage airport, it's really interesting because they have this huge billboard. Have you all seen this? They have a huge billboard right in the airport about the granting of statehood from territorial status. And if you start reading it, you realize that when Alaska was granted statehood, they originally thought Alaska would be a Democratic state and Hawaii would be a Republican state. So this political component is important. Another point I wanted to make, and this is, I think, because of the work of Eleanor and a series of mayors, you know, the district enjoys practically, right, on a kind of ad hoc basis, with the exception that we can all talk about in the breach of generally budget autonomy and legislative autonomy, but we're fighting to get legislative autonomy, budget autonomy, a vote for our congresswoman, not our delegate, our congresswoman, and two voting senators. It's kind of the hierarchy as we see it over the years.
Congressman Walsh.
I just say that history is instructive and it's important. And regardless of the current political situation where you have a gentrifying city where African Americans, our population is shrinking and non-African American population is growing. And in 1961, when you had a Democratic Congress and a Democratic president, and back at the turn of the 19th century, when whatever the makeup was, Whigs and Tories, I suppose, we as a people have been consistent that the District of Columbia shall remain neutral ground. It shall not be estate. And I think the dilemma is the people of the District of Columbia have the right to vote. They can vote for local officials. They can vote for the president. They just can't vote for a representative because the Constitution gives states that right. So that's the dilemma. I think many people would agree that taxation without representation is the wrong thing. But I think also many of those same people would say, we don't need statehood for a plot of land that's 68 square miles. The smallest state in the union is Rhode Island, and it's 25 times bigger. And so would you need, just practically speaking, a governance of a governor and a legislature and a mayor and a legislature and two United States senators and a representative to govern 68 square miles? I don't think so.
If I could reinforce, I think, all the points that have been made here. Jim is right about, we have a mayor and a city council, and isn't it a shame that it took us 150 years to get that? Home rule is very new, Jim. It's only 40 years old. And so for most of the life of this country, except for, interestingly, a few periods in the 19th century, the district had no democracy. I grew up in a city where there was no mayor, no city council. There were three commissioners appointed by the president. The whole thing was run by the Congress and the president. So even home rule was grudgingly given to the District of Columbia. And only, frankly, in the wake of the Civil Rights Movement, when by that time this was a heavily black city. And the Congress finally got shamed into giving the district home rule. But I also want to say, and this is to a point Jim made, there may be a racial element here, but I'm not sure it is. For one thing, for most of the life of this city, this was a majority white city. I went to segregated schools in this town. The majority was white. The majority was white forever until close to 1960. If you read the congressional record in the 19th century and you listen to the Southern Democrats, and you're absolutely right, Jim, the racists, the people who were doing the really bad work were the Democrats, they would openly say that the fact that there are black people there in any number is reason. I mean, the congressional record is full of it, is reason not to give the district its rights. So the Democrats are, if anything, more to blame than the Republicans. Tom Davis, a Republican, tried very hard to get us at least the House vote. And everybody worked with him. He had a perfect idea. One that plays off of, who mentioned Alaska?
Tony
mentioned Alaska, yeah. Which is another state, by the way, that has one representative, just like there's one of me. Tom recognized something that most of us did not, that the state of Utah was due to get a representative. And then the Census Bureau did something that it had never done before. It did not count its missionaries, which as a matter of religious faith, go, leave, and always come back. They did not count them at that time. And so for that reason, the Republicans were up in arms that they had lost the seat. And here comes Tom saying, okay, let's do what they did for Alaska and Hawaii or whoever it was, and let's just put the district with Utah. And guess what? Utah voted, went to its legislature, and agreed to become part of this pairing. And to show you, and this is to reinforce Jim's point, even when we had a Republican state, overwhelmingly Republican state, that wanted this, who would vote just the opposite from the way I would vote, undoubtedly, who wanted this seat so badly that they were willing to pair with us, the Republicans still wouldn't give the district a House seat.
Well, speaking,
no Senate involved in that, just a House seat.
So speaking of Utah, if the residents of the District of Columbia voted like Utah, do you think that would change the politics of this? Do you think the Republicans would be more supportive? Do you think the Democrats would be more opposed? Or is this something that's not really political, it's based on principle alone?
Well, I think that, I'll take a stab at that, if this was in Salt Lake City, yeah, and they'd make sure that the residents of Salt Lake City were fully empowered to vote, given the current makeup of the Congress. I do think that this is overwhelmingly a political issue. I have to say, Congressman Walsh, though, makes some I think, telling points that shouldn't be dismissed. I don't want to suggest that that the points he makes should be diminished in the argument. I think that they're perfectly reasonable. But on balance, I still think, even though it's a smaller geographical area, the fact that it has more voters than Wyoming or Vermont, I think.
But I would respectfully disagree a little bit. I mean, if you look at, you read the Wall Street Journal, Financial Times, any metric of a country, you know, there'll be GDP, employment, this metric or this or that activity. Last time I checked, I've never seen a metric of performance that was size of landmass. I mean, I think it's a nice thing to say, but it's kind of irrelevant, in all due respect, from my point of view. Now, politically, is it relevant? I think so. I think it resonates with Americans, but from a programmatic point of view, I can't understand it.
So let's say that the idea behind the landmass is a political argument and that there are other political arguments out there. Congressman Walsh, do you think that the Republicans would be more predisposed if D.C. did indeed vote more like Utah?
I honestly don't. I think that, you know, this building that we're in, it's built like a fortress for practical purposes and for illustrative purposes. It's containing the Constitution. It's a sacred document. And people, everything in this town is politics. Everything in life is politics. Tell me, you know, what you do, and I'll ask you about the office politics. But some things really do matter ultimately. And if it's enshrined in the Constitution of the United States that this be neutral ground for all intents and purposes, people respect that. All of us swear in as members of Congress, either on the Bible or the Constitution. I chose the Constitution. It's in a sea of trends and hashtags and everything else. Certain things are you touch ground on, and we did. The country did go out and amend the Constitution regarding the District of Columbia, but statehood was not part of that. Why not? Why wasn't it part of that? I don't know. I wasn't here for the debate. But I think it's important that we not just ascribe everything to politics, that principle and tradition does matter in this country. And I think that's, to the largest extent, the reason that the District of Columbia is not a state.
Well, Jim, respectfully take issue with, but I do appreciate your being the kind of the token antagonist here, because
I was afraid I was
going to have to be in that position the devil's advocate.
I did this during the financial difficulties of the city. I was a city councilman. I love cities. My dad was a mayor. I love this city. I still live here. I wanted it to be done right, but I played the bad cop to Tom Davis's good cop, because the people that read the newspapers were his constituents. They're not my constituents, so I played that role. I don't mind.
So let me get into casting you as the bad cop here on the constitutional issue, because when you talk about things that are enshrined in the Constitution, one of the things that was enshrined that was that only older white male property owners could vote.
But it was changed.
It was. And all we're talking about now is...
And they had a chance to change this one 50 years ago, and they didn't. Why?
Well, there were several efforts to change who could vote. Several efforts at the suffrage for women and minorities, and they continued to evolve. The reason why we're continuing this discussion is because a large share of the population and an even larger share of those who have dug into the issue feel that there is compelling reason to enable D.C. to act and to be considered as a state and to be classified as a state. But you know, the geographic mass is one thing, but I do think it's overridden by the size of the population and the size of the economy. This is a major economy within the United States of America, and there would be advantages, I think, to the whole country to recognize the District of Columbia as a state. Tony wanted to say.
Mayor Williams.
I want to salute Jim too, because he was a steadfast supporter of the district from his point of view during the control period, and we appreciate that and his support. But you know, it's interesting because we're talking about voting rights and civil rights. We're rolling now into the 150th anniversary of Reconstruction. So now I'm growing up with the continual efforts to advance civil rights. So growing up until I was able to read more widely, I always thought that basically nothing in the Constitution really specified civil rights, and we had to fight to change the Constitution to make all this happen. Well, come to find out, way back in Reconstruction, you talked to eminent constitutional scholars. In the Constitution, in the Civil War amendments, in legislation passed right after the end of the Civil War, it pretty much granted equal rights to African Americans. And we ignored the Constitution for 100 years until in the 60s we began to recognize what the Constitution was saying. So this works two different ways. The Constitution, as Jim is saying, is an evolving document. Sometimes we look at it and we abide by it, sometimes we don't, but it's not cast in stone.
No, I want to accept Jim Walsh's notion that as a matter of principle, no matter who's involved, this is where he would stand, and I think there are some people like him. But again, I've got to use evidence. First of all, the evidence is that the Congress has never used principle to decide who would get into the Union. Before slavery, before the end of slavery, a slave state could not get in unless a free state got in. Alaska did not get in unless Hawaii got in. So anybody who can show me where as a principled matter that a state got in the Union, I would like you to raise your hand. It was always a political matter, and it is a political matter now. There may be some who have some kind of principle here, but if so, that is really not how the Congress has ever, whatever the period, decided. And as the principle, the Democrats, when I came to Congress, I wrote a memo that was simply based on existing procedure. I said, I note that I have the right to vote in committee. That is, for me, a very valuable right. When the House meets on the floor, it sometimes meets, not always, in the Committee of the Whole. Committees, including the Committee of the Whole, were not created by the Constitution, but by the Congress. Respectfully, I ask to vote in the Committee of the Whole. The Democrats were in power. Tom Foley sent it out to outside lawyers. They came back and said, it is in your discretion. They gave me the right to vote on the House floor. The Republicans sued. They sued in the district court here and went all the way to the Court of Appeals before they gave up. In each of those courts, the courts did not say we had a right to vote in the Committee of the Whole, but it did say, in your discretion, you could give them that right in the Committee of the Whole. And there had been all, it had been surrounded with all kinds of things that wouldn't make our vote, you know, really the thing that did something that Congress didn't want to do. So, you know, to say, in your discretion, in a sense, to me, that was saying, in your largesse, as a democracy, you may decide to do that, even though you're not compelled to do it. So, Jim, I have to respectfully say, I don't have any evidence, either in this Congress or in historical Congresses, that when it comes to who gets the vote and who doesn't get the vote, that there are people who, in any number at least, notwithstanding that there will be individual members, will stand on principle rather than on the politics of the day.
Well, let's address another principle which a couple of folks have raised, and that's the principle, a founding principle of no taxation without representation. I'm sure many of those of us who live in the district would wish that we had somebody in Congress who could vote on those final bills to whether we are taxed and how our money is spent, okay? So it's a fundamental principle that's coded into our society, our culture, our laws. Yet that does seem to be violated for approximately 600,000 people. So the question then becomes, if we can't fulfill that principle, should the District of Columbia residents not have to pay federal taxes?
I'll comment, but since nobody else does. I think it will be the largest city in the world very quickly if that were to happen. I might even give up my voting rights in New York. Why not? Why not? If that's the way, if everybody feels that that's fair, then I wouldn't oppose that. But there is a third way to do this, and the third way is to create a much smaller federal city, treat it like a national park. Many people think it's a park anyway, and then cede the rest back to Maryland, who gave it to us in the first place. And then it's you have voting representation, you have two senators, you have a representative, and everybody's made whole.
Thoughts on that?
Jim made a point about neutral ground. If we were a state, the federal enclave would be neutral ground. So the neutral ground
right.
would be preserved, and we'd be a state.
That's right.
I agree with Jim. Yeah, I don't know about the biggest, but we sure have more people than any other place. And I tested this, though. I just got so disgusted with being unable to get the vote. That I myself put in the bill to test it. And Democrats followed me because they said, okay, only says this is, then it must be the way. I said, I was only testing one Republican. They were in charge. I never did it again. I tell you why. I don't want it. First of all, I have tested it on DC residents. They don't want it. You ask a DC resident, they will tell you, I want the vote. I didn't ask you for money. Beyond that, and you'll find some, of course, who say, no, I'll take the money. You can take the mayor or, you know, Aunt Tony Williams, you know, he's a nice guy. But the demographic point that Jim makes would be overwhelming. Now, imagine what DC is going through now, where the papers say that there is no moderate housing here. I mean, this is like a lot of big cities, you know? The market rules, and the market means that it is difficult to find a place to live in this city. But there's another very important technical reason. This bill was introduced, I'm not sure it's been introduced this year, by Representative Gohmert of Texas. And in his introductory statement, he said, my bill would mean that the District of Columbia, like, by the way, and this is an important point, like the territories, would pay no taxes, like the territories. We don't want to be a territory, not just because it's called a territory. The territories do not get what the district gets. We get the same federal programs that Syracuse gets, that the region gets. In fact, you will often see 50 states in the District of Columbia. We are treated like a state for every purpose except the final vote on the House floor. So if we were to, give up what we have now, we would have to raise taxes a great deal, because we'd have to make up for the funds we would lose in federal programs. So we don't want it that way. We want it the way every other territory, and they were called territories before they became states, got it. We were never called a territory, and we were never a territory.
It's a good point, because we had bipartisan support, Eleanor will know, for example, when Medicaid, to remember about 10 years or so ago, to get our Medicaid treatment the same as any other state, as opposed to like a territory. That's an excellent point.
Mm-hmm. When you look at interstate commerce, it's commerce between DC and any other state, it's considered interstate. So that's sort of written into those laws as well. I do have another question, and then I want to be able to kick it to all of you to ask some questions. And that is the issue of race that was brought up before. There are many who say that some of the voter ID laws and some of the increasing restrictions on early voting are driven politically to minimize or suppress minority voting in certain states. Right now we have 34 states that have voter ID laws. According to some estimates, approximately 10 or 11% of American citizens do not have adequate ID to be able to vote under those laws. In the state of Texas, adequate ID is if you have a concealed gun permit, but your University of Texas ID is not sufficient. So is there a connection between the lack of enthusiasm among some for voting rights and representation in the district and some of these other voter ID laws, or is this just much ado from the pundits trying to make a connection where none exists? Congressman Moran?
Well, I think that voter suppression, to the extent it exists, and it clearly has existed and will continue to exist, I don't know for how long, but it does exist in particularly in the deep southern states. It's for political reasons, to gain a political advantage, knowing what precincts are going to vote Democratic. If you're a Republican legislature, you can inadequately fund the voting booths. You can put up restrictions, particularly with regard to having to show ID and so on. I think it's a more modern, a bit more moderate form than the states used to use, which prohibited an African American from being able to vote effectively. I mean, it wasn't just the poll tax; you would have to guess how many, marbles were in a jar or whatever. Just impossible things. They don't use as many outrageous things now, but I do think that it's clear what the intent is, and some voting officials have even acknowledged what the intent is to hold down, in this case, almost exclusively, it's the minority vote. It's a little different in the District of Columbia. The motivation may be consistent, but in D.C., there's no efforts to suppress the number of people coming out to vote. It's just that the empowerment of those voters is suppressed as long as they can't vote for the kind of representation people in other states can vote for. So I see it as quite a different variant, but I suppose it's still part of the same idea of the manipulation of the results of elections. I don't know, though, that I would put it in the same category as the current effort to do away with that kind of suppression and the effort to enhance voting rights.
You know, I agree. I agree on that because if you think about it, the denial of voting rights and every other right for the District of Columbia far predates anything having to do with voter ID laws. And I don't think that voter ID laws are entirely racial at all. I think it's because minorities tend to be Democrats. So I think that it has much more to do with the fact that they are suppressing the Democratic vote than they are suppressing the black vote. Look who else they're suppressing. Young people of every kind. Did you give the Texas example?
Mm-hmm.
Far outnumber minorities. So that again is just in the political category that DC voting rights and DC statehood has always been in.
I think there's no question there's a history in this country, primarily in the South, of the either the party in power or which in this case, in most cases, was Democratic. And I really appreciate the fact that Eleanor recognized that Republicans have done good things in terms of civil rights in this country. We actually delivered the majorities for the Civil Rights Act in 1961, and the force of moral authority to get rid of the poll taxes and the other taxes in the South that were heinous, that were very much racially motivated. But I agree with my two colleagues. I just don't think this is a matter of race in this case. I think district is a very different, unique animal, and are there politics in it? Yes, no question. Everybody thinks in terms, somewhat in terms of politics, some more than others. But there's also a constitutional issue here that has not been resolved. Because as we've seen, as both of my colleagues made the point, that we have changed the Constitution. Justice Taney determined that, you know, a good Democrat from or I'm not even sure what he was, if he's from Maryland, determined that African Americans are not one full person. What an incredible decision that was, a horrible decision. We changed that. Maybe someday the country will be ready to change the Constitution relating to the District of Columbia. And when it is, I will salute it, because that's the will of the people and that's the process that we have. But until then, and we did have the opportunity back in the 60s, it didn't happen.
I think it's only fair to indicate where the best politics came from until the 1960s. D.C., after the Civil War, for the first time, the District of Columbia got the same form of government we have now, basically. They had a delegate, a mayor, a city council. Guess who gave it to them? The so-called radical Republicans. Guess how they lost it? With Reconstruction, when Reconstruction went, and a Democrat was elected president, was it Andrew Johnson? I forget who it was, yeah. Was elected president almost immediately.
He was a Republican.
Who?
Hayes.
When the Democrats,
after Reconstruction, it was Hayes, yes, a Republican, and it was who beat Tilden, yes, right.
To get elected.
Mm-hmm.
It was the Democrats who took away the district's home rule, which was a matter that came to us entirely from Republicans. It was Republicans who were against slavery. It were Democrats who were for slavery. You see all this stuff about the Confederate flag? It's Democrats, not Republicans. And Jim is right. Very hard, very difficult to get the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and 65. And the difference was made by Republicans. So you can talk about the politics of D.C. statehood or D.C. voting rights, but if you get down to race, if anything, Democratic hands are as dirty and dirtier throughout history than Republican hands. And since Republicans have opposed home rule and the rest, it has really not been on racial grounds. They do not raise racial slogans. Whereas when Democrats were against our home rule and against blacks generally, they were not reticent at all about bringing race into the picture.
I want to open it up to questions. We have microphones on each side, so please, that's where I ask you ask a question. So, please.
I think this is more of a comment than a question. I'm absolutely sort of seething up here. The confusion between what it means to be a state and voting rights, what the issue is for the district residents of the District of Columbia, and it goes back to the fact, as Congressman Norton pointed out, we were part of the United States. We were part of the 13 colonies. The people who lived here fought in the Revolution for what? Not voting rights. Voting rights is just a means to an end. The end is self-government. We had self-government. We had it during that transition period. We had varying limited forms for the first 74 years of the District of Columbia, where we elected some 20-some different mayors and parts of councils, and Congress changed the law all over the place. And I think if you go back and you look at the history books and start reading the congressional record and look at the inaugural addresses and what presidents have said for the last 215 years, you will see time and time and time again people saying, how can we take the rights from full and free Americans, take them away, and as President William Henry Harrison said in his inaugural address, make them the subjects of the people of the state. And the state is important, and this is what people don't understand, because it is the building block. Yeah. It is the block.
If you have a question, it would be great to get to it.
Yeah, well, it's the building block for what the people created. And what I just find listening to this discussion is this misunderstanding of even what our government is and why statehood is important, and its powers are different than having an elected representative in Congress. And Congresswoman Norton can tell you all the different bills that have nothing to do with whether she has a vote, but has to do with the fact that Congress is our unelected state legislature.
Any reflections, comments? Well, we'll take a question from this side.
Congresswoman Norton, you mentioned briefly the term territory. And I wondered from all of you, but particularly you, whether as a statehood advocate you have allied with or have strong feelings about the status of Guam and Puerto Rico and American Samoa as it relates to this discussion. There was a conversation a little bit earlier about racial aspects, and I do wonder whether, given that those three territories are, of course, almost completely non-white, whether that is why we hear so much more about D.C. statehood and representation than we do about those areas' representation issues.
Well, actually, that's not why. It's a very good question, though, because we have five territories. And yes, they happen to be territories of color. By the way, they have very few people in each of them, whereas the district has always had enough people to become a state. I am very closely allied with the territories, but it is very important to note that the territories have no issue with me when I want statehood or voting rights, because they like not paying taxes. In a real sense, they have the best of both worlds. They do get most of what we get. They don't get the same thing that Jim and I and Jim get, but they do get most of what we get, and they don't have to pay taxes for it. So when they have never, ever, in fact, when I got the vote in the Committee of the Whole, although I went to get the vote in the Committee of the Whole for the district, the Democrats gave it to them too, even though there's a stark difference between them and me. So we work very closely together, but they do not ask for either voting rights or statehood.
Puerto Rico is a little bit of a difference because it is a populous island, and they have a sweet deal, but there are a lot of people within Puerto Rico that do want statehood. It's a That's very true. Divisive issue.
And they will have less of a chance of getting it because they would have six representatives.
Well, President Bush the first proposed in his State of the Union, in his inaugural address, that he'd like to see Puerto Rico become a state, but the people of Puerto Rico are of three minds.
Yeah.
Some want statehood, some want independence, some want it just the way it is. Right. And it's their right to determine what that will be. And right now, status quo is a territory. Yes.
Hi. I'm Michael Brown. I am the United States Senator for the District of Columbia, one of them, commonly referred to as the Shadow Senator because I'm not recognized by Congress. But I have two quick comments I'd like to make. To Congressman Welsh, there was a
Walsh,
I'm sorry. There was a constitutional amendment, the Voting Rights Act, that would have given the District of Columbia two senators and a voting representative. And although it wasn't about statehood per se, it would have done very much the same thing. And the battle in the Senate was led by a Republican from Massachusetts named Ed Brook. So there have been Republicans that have supported this idea in the past. And other than that, I want to say our biggest problem, as far as I see it, is that we don't put any money into our effort. 80% of America, when they were polled, said that they believe the people of the District of Columbia should have the same rights as everybody else. But unfortunately, 80% of those people also believe that we already did, because it's counterproductive to think that in the home, the citadel of democracy, there's no democracy. So we need to put some money into this effort. We expend $200,000 a year on it when we need to expend millions. And I think back to something that Congresswoman Norton said to me and a bunch of other people in a meeting: nothing's ever generated within the walls of this building. The pressure has to come from outside. So in order for us to become a state, we need to put pressure on Congress. We're the only people with a dog in this fight, really. And we need to reach out across the country. And to do that, we need to dedicate some resources. Thank you.
Well, let me take off of that comment and ask a question. Congressman Moran said, you know, you didn't see it in our lifetimes that this might happen. But what if there were a coordinated effort? What if there were lots of money put into it? What if it were turned into a nationwide campaign to be able to sort of provide what many people think might exist but doesn't? Do you think that would make a difference? Raising the temperature on this issue. Anyone? Anyone? Does it give anyone hope if we actually raise the temperature on this? If it became a nationwide campaign? If it became the equivalent of what we saw in the 1980s about drunk driving, okay, a massive campaign about that. And all of the other campaigns that have come, the anti-tobacco campaign, would that be something that you think could possibly change things?
Do you believe in democracy? If you believe in democracy, you have to believe that if you could get to the people, and of course, we can't. And Mike is absolutely right when he says, you know, they don't know what they don't know, and we don't have any way to tell them. But if you believe in democracy, you have to believe that if you have the resources and the wherewithal to let people know, they would in fact not want their capital to be without a vote. And I'll give you another historic example, which was much closer. And still people had to fight. Our statehood senator's notion that about we've got to, you know, we've got to inform people, we've got to do it, we are the ones with a dog in this fight, is very important. Why is it that women got the right to vote only in 1920? I mean, these people slept with white men. gave birth to them, and still did not get the vote until they handcuffed themselves to the White House gate. So if you want it in this country, it's a democracy. You got to fight for it. And if we had more resources to fight for it, it would be easier to fight for it.
Yes.
My question is, we talked earlier, Congresswoman, you talked a little bit about a court case that decided that the Congress did have, it was in its purview to give you that right to that committee vote. My big question is, if it took the 23rd Amendment to give D.C. the right to an electoral college vote, wouldn't it take another amendment to the Constitution to get those two senators and a representative? And it's not as simple as just passing a bill. And I think to segue into your point, sir, wouldn't it take really a national campaign in order to get the 3/4 of the states to actually approve said amendment? And why, if it wouldn't take that, what about those court cases made it different than why we needed a 23rd Amendment in the first place?
I think that's a good question. And I believe there would be a divided opinion on it. This is Jim has been in pains to say this is a federal territory. Well, I've already given you a precedent where Congress gave the district the right to vote during the transition. It was Congress that took it away. If they have jurisdiction over the territory, it would seem that they would have the authority to, in fact, make it a state. Let's assume that they don't. The arbiter of that is the Supreme Court of the United States, not party politics. So if you believe that the District of Columbia is entitled to be treated, or at least its residents, then you let it happen, and if it's not constitutional, the final decision will not be for Republicans who may be against it, or Democrats who may be for it, but will be pursuant to the Constitution.
And just a quick follow-up to that, then, do you believe that inevitably that would go to the Supreme Court if this were to pass?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Inevitably. In fact, I was a constitutional lawyer in my former better life, I should say. And I can tell you that there is no significant law that is not tested for its constitutionality. Even insignificant laws are tested for their constitutionality. So we're prepared for that.
Anyone else? Yes.
I was wondering, with the original District of Columbia being from both Virginia and Maryland, and with the territory that was originally in Virginia being mostly federally, the federal government sits half over there with the State Department, Defense, and Patent Office, and so on and so forth. What if that were reunited, giving the rest of Virginia back to the conservatives, and give the D.C. its liberal senators? It evens out. No one is lost. And eventually, maybe it changes. Maybe they shift their positions. But right away, no one loses. And then suddenly, also, the conservatives in the rest of Virginia would have a dog in the fight, too.
I wouldn't do that to Jim, but I'll let him answer. Yeah.
I like the 10 by 10.
I think you can make a case for the Washington metropolitan area to be a state, because it has Northern Virginia, for example, Alexandria, Arlington, Falls Church, has more in common culturally, and I think to some extent economically, with the District of Columbia than does Richmond. And if you look at the makeup of the legislature in Richmond, it largely reflects rural areas that have little in common with Northern Virginia. And in fact, Northern Virginia is the engine that drives the rest of the state economy. In most public schools, for example, the state funds 80% of the school costs. In Northern Virginia, it funds less than 20%. Northern Virginia schools are far superior than the rest of the state. And in terms of the Maryland suburbs, you don't have as much political disparity between Annapolis and the Maryland suburbs, but nevertheless, there is a cohesive community here in the Washington metropolitan area, and the Council of Governments, the Federal City Council, they recognize that, and they work quite closely together. And of course, the metro system ties us all together. We have one public transit system, and it works quite well. I don't think that's ever going to happen. Richmond is not going to give up the revenue that comes out of Northern Virginia. Annapolis is not going to give up the revenue that comes out of suburban Maryland. The suburbs of Washington subsidize both states. And I don't think that D.C. would want to dilute its political representation. So while it's an interesting theoretical idea, it's not going to happen. I guess I'll end there.
Just if it makes you feel any better, upstate New York has thought for years about separating New York City off and letting them go their own way. But that will never happen either.
Well, let me close up with one other question, which is that if it's not going to happen, if statehood or representation in the House and Senate is not going to happen, what's the alternative? Is there a solution? Is it just the status quo that we have for years on end and more conversations like this of people talking on one side or the other, saying, well, it's in the Constitution, or no, it's politics, or so on. But clearly we have a situation where you have hundreds of thousands of people that don't have a voting voice in the whole of the House and the whole of the Senate. And no matter how one looks at the Constitution and what those original intents were or desires or even the wording, you have large numbers of people who don't have that voting representation. Is there a way out of this? Is there a solution? Is there a way to deal with it that's realistic beyond just the hypothetical? Anything?
Well, I'll take a stab at that if I could, because I didn't want to answer honestly when you asked, is there really any hope, no matter how much heat we put up, you know, is anything going to happen? Because the answer is no, it's not going to change. And I appreciate Eleanor's belief in democracy and so on. I know it's strongly held. It's just that she's also a realist. I don't mean to be condescending, because she knows better than I do the reality of the Congress she has to work in. It's just not in the cards until that makeup changes. And as soon as there was a Democratic caucus, they immediately elevated Eleanor's status to what it should have been. But again, that was politics on the Democrat side. But there are things that can be done. The metro system is an example where the suburbs are integrally tied to the District of Columbia. We have a public transit system. They understand that it wouldn't function if the jobs weren't as plentiful in the district as they are. And I do think there are ways to be creative in the financing to enable the District of Columbia to gain to an even greater extent from commuting. One of the things we haven't mentioned, and one of the reasons why it was difficult to be an advocate for statehood when you're representing a suburb, is the threat of a commuter tax. A state can impose a commuter tax, and obviously where you sit is often where you stand on issues like that, and the suburbs don't want that. But if you've got hot lanes coming in now all the way from Stafford County, and you've got the MARC trains coming in, as long as they go all the way into the district, this should be, I think, an even more equitable exchange in terms of the revenue coming in from those transit systems. It's a different form of a commuter tax, but I think it's one that would be far more acceptable. And as the population moves further out, and a lot of that is because they telecommute, so they buy houses where it's cheaper, and then, you know, on Tuesday and Wednesday the traffic gets more congested, but on Monday and Friday you can zip and on the regular lanes. But those hot lanes, I think, should have gone all the way into the District of Columbia, and the district should have gotten a larger share of the revenue coming from those hot lanes. And I'd like to see that happen with VRE, with MARC, with all of our transit systems, so that where the district can take advantage, and I think fairly so, of the fact that it is still the job generator. I also think there are ways that we, in terms of the development around those public transit systems, where the district could be a greater beneficiary than it now is.
Anyone else?
I think if Maryland, Virginia, and the district work together on some issues, in the way that Jim says, you're advertising the power of the district and the importance of the district, so you're getting at the point the senator was making, and you're also achieving a good economic outcome as well.
I think everyone on this panel is correct that statehood is far off, and yet we fight and struggle for it as if it might happen in the next Congress. That is how subordinated people in the United States have always done it. That is how the free blacks did it, when there wasn't a ghost of a chance that we would come free. And you do it enough, what happens is events turn the table. Events make an opening. Now, the District of Columbia wanted statehood when we got home rule in 1974. And there were some people who made fun of getting home rule, but I can tell you this. The majority did not decide, if you can't get statehood, then we want to keep it the way it is. And so they got and were glad to get home rule, and home rule, frankly, did give Mayor Williams the right to run the city. It's only in a few ways that Congress interferes during the appropriation that you would think that Congress had anything to do with the district. So what does the district want now? I can tell you that first the district wants statehood. But when Tom Davis said he would fight for that House vote, the district overwhelmingly was with him for the House vote. They didn't say, oh, if you can't give me statehood, then I want to sit here with no vote whatsoever. In other words, they knew where they were. They knew what country they were in. And they knew how people have gotten their rights. Today, if you ask the District of Columbia, I'll give you a perfect example. Why did the District of Columbia have a referendum if they want statehood so much that overwhelmingly approved budget autonomy? Because they want what they can get of their rights as soon as they can get it. So they want budget autonomy, they want legislative autonomy, they want no shutdown language. In other words, if it's not the whole thing, we're not going to sit here and say, well, I'm not doing nothing until you all, you know, get your heads on straight. We're going for each and every crumb of it that is ours. At the same time, we're putting in a statehood bill where we get overwhelmingly, where we get more and more people for statehood. And by the way, not every Democrat is for statehood. So when I say more and more Democrats come on, that shows you that we are building towards statehood. And we particularly made the effort this year in the Senate and the House, when both houses were taken over by the Republicans, to say, take that. And enough of taking that, events open up, things change, and things happen.
Well, I think it is a truism in American politics that if things won't happen unless you seize the opportunity, seize the moment, and actually put your heart and soul into it. And we have a panel tonight that's distinguished, thoughtful, articulate, who put their heart and soul into this evening, and I'm very grateful. Let's hear it for our
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you. Thanks very much.